Thank you, everybody, for coming to the talk. Thank you, Liam, for the introduction. As Liam mentioned, we are now at VMware, at the office of the CTO, which may surprise some of you. VMware has traditionally been an infrastructure company, pioneered some of the foundations for, you know, what is the cloud now with virtualization, but it's not had traditionally reach developers, and that's part of what we're trying to change from the inside. A lot of people believe at VMware, including ourselves, that WebAssembly is the future of infrastructure, or it's going to play like a big role, and we're trying to make our part on making that happen. It's a small team, about five people. It's only two of us here, but a lot of what you're going to see today has been like a group effort. As Liam mentioned, we have a background open source. I was smiling through the previous presentation. I contributed to Mono about 20 years ago. It was a module to connect Mono with Apache so you could run ASP.NET, you know, back in 2002 or 2003. And in a way, what we're going to be presenting today is related to that. Both of us have background in what we call now cloud native. With Bitnami, we created cloud images and Helm charts and containers. And if you take a look at what is the definition from the CNCF around cloud native, it includes service meshes, it includes containers. So, you know, it's microservices. And if you ask me, like, a couple of years ago, I will wholeheartedly agree that if you're building like a modern application, you're building a new application, of course you're going to use containers. Of course you're going to deploy these on Kubernetes because that's the way forward. But the more that we got into WebAssembly, the more that we have been looking at this and what's happening, the more that I realized that it's one way of creating modern applications and that WebAssembly itself is opening a whole variety of new ways of deploying and building and creating modern applications. The first one that is how everybody originally got excited about WebAssembly is building desktop-like applications or bringing functionality that used to be very compute intensive and normally you will do on your own device. You can bring that to the browser. And that can be porting an existing code base like Google Earth, or you can embrace this from a, you know, the get-go, kind of like what Figma did, right? And hopefully that's also bringing this, you know, recent Figma successes are bringing more people to pay attention to kind of like the underlying technology that they used to get to that point. A lot of the companies here, including, you know, Wasm Cloud, Fermion, Suborbital, they are pioneering a new way of doing things in the edge around serverless and taking advantage of all the capabilities of WebAssembly in that regard that we have seen in the previous talks around isolation, zero cold starts, and to kind of bring a different flavor of serverless that doesn't necessarily need to use containers or in many ways benefit from not having that overhead. And finally, there is also a new crop of what we call modern embedded applications, and probably Prime Video and Disney Plus are two of the examples. These are streaming applications that need to run in a variety of devices, that in a variety of different CPUs, typically very constrained, in many cases not even running Linux. And they have been able to leverage WebAssembly to solve a lot of the portability problems or the portability overhead without sacrificing performance. And today we want to add a new category to that list. And kind of following in the footstep of the previous presenter have talked about, you know, ways that you can bring Java developers or way that you can take the .NET community, you know, forward to WebAssembly with Blazor. We would love to bring traditional web developers, those developers that are building applications with PHP, with Python, with Ruby, to the world of WebAssembly. And you know, why are we doing this? As we mentioned, as part of our mission at VMware is we want to help onboard developers to WebAssembly or kind of like increase the footprint of developers that have access and use WebAssembly on a day-to-day. you know, what a bigger community that, you know, people working with PHP or working with Python. And to do that, we need to be very conscious of what, you know, was just discussed like a few minutes ago, which is the developer experience. Ideally, we want to do this without radically changing what we need to do, what they need to do to kind of adopt this. We want to, in a way, meet them where they are, and once they have experienced that, once they can take advantage of all the good things that WebAssembly brings to them, then we can kind of take them to the future and start using it in other ways. And that is something that we experience at Bitnami. You know, we have millions, or still has millions of users of the stacks that we provide. And part of that is not that you know, we're doing anything, you know, revolutionary. Primarily what we're doing is we were packaging that for convenience, we're packaging that for ease of use, and that has a kind of a quality of its own. Like, the more widely spread that your software is, the more that you can bring that to people who, you know, or may have trouble like getting it to the point of running, but once it is running, they can do a lot of things with it. It unlocks a whole set of new use cases, and, you know, potentially coming from a different perspective of the more sophisticated use cases that the people in this room are able to achieve. And that's kind of like why we decided to do this. And how did we decide where to start? We decided to take the most popular scripting language, at least for web development, and take the most popular application. In this case, it's WordPress. WordPress, and I assume most of the people here are familiar with it, is a content management system that runs 30 to 40%, depending on which source you check, of the web, including high-profile websites such as Disney or the White House. And that's not a typo. That's not 30 or 40% of all the content management systems. That's like 30, 40% of all the websites, right, across all the sizes. You know, the top 10,000 and the top million is, you know, the percentage is fairly consistent. So if we get that working in WebAssembly, that means that you can get a lot of other things working. And going back to meeting developers where they are, most of the people deploying PHP applications are doing so on top of the LAMP stack, which was kind of like the first way of the first wave of web development back in the 90s. And that, you know, create like a standardized way of creating applications that you could easily deploy on different hosts, because you could always kind of assume that you will have LAMP. And that is an acronym that stands for Linux, MySQL, Apache, and PHP. And in the spirit of, you know, meeting and making that transition seamless and, you know, requiring little to no changes, we leave Apache as it is. You can assume that Apache is going to be in any, you know, hosting service or any Linux distribution that you use. We will replace modphp, which is the module that enables PHP to interface with Apache. And it's kind of, PHP has this concept of server APIs or SAPIs, and that PHP provides that. We will replace that with mod WebAssembly, or mod Wasm, that enables you to provide that interface instead of to the PHP runtime, to a WebAssembly runtime that in turn will run PHP. Because you still have PHP, the way that we did that is similar to how Chris provided details of how they ported Python. The path to do so is very similar. Once you have compiled PHP to WASI, and we will be showing that later on, all of that is now released and open source, you can run PHP inside mod Wasm inside Apache. MySQL, we will not touch, we'll leave there. For the purpose of the demos that you're gonna see today and kind of the initial work, we have focused on SQLite, but the idea is in the very near future, you will be also be able to run this with PHP. So in terms of how mod Wasm works, and I'm not gonna go into a lot of detail. We have some articles that describe this and some other presentations that we have done that you can find online. It's divided in kind of like two pieces. There's the first piece, which is mod Wasm. This is a regular Apache module. It's written in C. It uses the Apache API. is a very well-defined API that is used by, you know, nearly everything in Apache is a module. So if you have a module that implements SSL, TLS, you have a module that implements session caching, you have a module that implements support for you know, PHP with mod PHP, you have mod Python, you have kind of like different modules for integrating different runtimes or providing functionality. In this case, mod Wasm is an interface between Apache and a different module, which integrates, is written in Rust, and integrates the ability to instantiate WebAssembly modules to respond to requests. And it kind of asks in between, it takes the request from Apache, processes them in a way that the WebAssembly runtime is gonna understand, and then take the output from that request, send it back to Apache so it can send it back to the client or to the browser. In this particular first release that we're doing with this, we use a Wasm time from the Bytecode Alliance, which you're all familiar with. In terms of how this is implemented from the PHP perspective, we there is versions of PHP that work with Inscripten. We have like a popular demo that we released a few months ago of showing WordPress running in the browser and using some of the functionality that Inscripten provided in terms of simulating a lot of these different pieces that are missing from kind of server side WebAssembly. In this case, we ported a subset of PHP to WASI, and instead of having to compile in the PHP interpreter and tie that to mod PHP, it's a loadable module. So when the request comes to Apache, the Wasm runtime realizes that that's like a PHP request, has already loaded the module. You can preload that at startup time, and then go interpret the PHP, index.php or WordPress.php, take the result and provide that back to Apache. And this is very similar to how PHP works currently. Again, our goal here was not to be more efficient or to provide more functionality than mod PHP. It was just to match what people already have. And in the spirit of having live demos, I will leave you now with Rafael, who is gonna be giving you a demo of how we have all of this working.
Thank you. Okay, so let's see an example of how this works. So the first thing that I'm going to load here, if I find my cursor, it's PHP info. So this call is something you can write in your PHP program. And when you call to this function basically prints some HTML code on the standard output, and it's going to fill all the information about the PHP runtime. Here is super small. Let me make that bigger, I guess. Okay. And here you can see that the system, we're not going to go through all configuration, but the system is Wasm 32 WASI. So this is what we were looking for. And you can see that what we have ported, what we have built is 7.3.33 at this time. So this is for the PHP version. So let me show you the current status of the project. So we have PHP 7.3.33, as we have seen. We have the PHP CLI that you can use to run scripts, like PHP scripts, regularly, like without any changes. We also have the PHP CGI binary, which is what interacts in this way, as Daniel described before. And what we have done has been to build PHP with WASI SDK. Nowadays, WASI SDK has really good defaults. Let's say it's pretty easy in a general way to build programs with it. And we have used the WASI libc to provide the POSIX fillings for it. Okay, so what are the things that we had to emulate? In this case, this is everything comes from WASI libc. There are some things that we could emulate with it. You can see we have been all day talking about it. We don't have signals. Also, we have some emulated logic for clocks. Get PID. Get PID doesn't make sense to have processes on WebAssembly, so it returns a fixed number and that's it. But so there are some things that can be emulated, because in this case, this part can be emulated and that's it. But there are some things that we had to remove that we cannot emulate. And for example, in terms of PHP, we have opcache. Opcache is some mechanism that PHP has inside or has on its engine, that whenever it reads through the PHP code, it converts that into a bytecode and stores the bytecode in memory. And so when you do further requests or it is going to interpret the PHP file again, it doesn't need to start from scratch. So it starts from what it already has in the bytecode. So we have to strip that. And as a result, of course, things will be slower. Even with opcache, we don't know, but without it, it will be slower for sure. So yeah, things we had to remove, things related to processes, we don't have this concept as we were saying before. Anything that has to do with socket creation or handling, we don't have that again. So then the send engine has some feature that uses set jump and long jump in order to implement exception handling. So the engine, whenever it's compiling the PHP code to bytecode, it can raise exceptions. So this PHP runtime has set jump and long jump in order to implement this mechanism to be able to, get these errors and report them back to the user. Also, things related to mutexes or certain file system functionality, file system logs, file logs, change owner, you must, things that we don't have. But despite we don't have all these things, we were able to build something as complex, or not to build, to use something as complex as WordPress. So we can still do something like that. So let me go through the demo of WordPress. Okay, so we have an installation of WordPress. It's really simple. It just contains the basic installation. So you can actually go and visit like the blog post. It's just, the basic navigation that you can have on a regular WordPress installation. You have pages and all that works. Also, in terms of what we were saying about the CGI, we have, if you have a script that implements or uses the features that will be in the end using CGI, we can have a single, for example, PHP script that I can show to you. For example, this one is able to set the response code, for example, to AMA teapot. It can set response headers. It can read headers from the request that we are getting as an input. And it can, for example, print to JSON certain hash, for example, the request to the request that we got and the headers that we have been collecting here before. So we can try to trigger a request here. And then, you see, for example, we get from the curl directly the expected HTTP request. We see that there are certain headers that are set by PHP CGI itself. There are others that are set by us. And then, just the body that we just return from our script. And then we can, of course, do more complex requests. Let's say we can have something like query parameters, our own headers, and everything gets filled into the WebAssembly module. So you can see that here in the request. So let me go back again. Okay, so how does this plug into Apache? So with Apache, what you have to do is to load the module, so Apache is aware of mod Wasm, And then you can see on the location part, it's on gray, maybe it's not very readable. Here what we are saying is just put in the root, and what we are saying here is that from the root on, in this case, then you can override that afterwards if you want, but for in this case, from the root on, what we are going to do is to add a handler for PHP file extensions. We are going to use the Wasm handler. And so what we can do is to configure, in this case, mod Wasm to say what is the root of the of WebAssembly, what is the module, in this case is PHP CGI. We can pre-open certain directories, we can mount, or not mount, but map directories into the WebAssembly runtime, or set certain environment variables. Okay, so what are the advantages and trade-offs of this approach? So first of all, the upsides of running web applications with Wasm is security. So we have the sandboxing feature of WebAssembly that already helps us with path traversals or buffer overflows. We can also mix and match languages. So for example, we could have different endpoints that are served by different languages, depending on what is your backend written on, even if it's split or whatever. We can also even, in this special case of the previous one, we can mix and match runtime versions. So certain paths can be run by PHP 7, others by PHP 8, for example. And also isolation. So improvements for traditional shared hosting implementations, like what we were saying, on the file system side, it can help you. Also, if we talk about the fuel feature of Wasm time, for example, we are able to if we have noisy neighbors on our machine, we can kind of control all this execution time that we get with fuel. And then in terms of extensibility, we can extend WordPress with Wasm plugins. And in terms of the external one, if we want to port our program in different steps from one language to another, or just a part of it, we can still do that. Because with WebAssembly, as we have seen in previous sessions, we can do that step by step as we can, or as we wish. But there are also trade-offs. We haven't measured it, but we know that the performance is obviously worse. We have to check how worse it is, and we have to check what can we do to improve it. And there is also missing functionality. So we know that we have feelings for these things that are missing. But you know, there are some things that we cannot feel in any case, right? So there are certain calls that the PHP script might call, but we don't have this implementation at all. And it's like, maybe this doesn't make sense to have on PHP itself, like on the WebAssembly side of things. Okay, so as far as the future, we want to contribute these patches upstream for PHP 7 and PHP 8. We also want to explore using WASIX so that if you have heard the previous presentations, it's like it feels like there is a lot of people doing like parallel work, and we are kind of doing the very similar work. And maybe WASIX, for example, could be something that if we agree as a community to move on with it, might improve all of us or might help all of us. It can also run on serverless worker-like environments. So before we didn't really explore this that much, but with the new way of doing things with WebAssembly, we can have our PHP code deployed into serverless and see if that improves the user experience for our users. And then for the future also of PHP, we have asyncify, which is a method that we can use to implement certain features. So with asyncify, we are able to resume and pause WebAssembly execution. And so what we can do is to have alternate execution paths. So for example, this is used for implementing exceptions. And the idea would be that with asyncify, we are able to implement the missing bits and pieces for set jump and long jump. Because in this case, if we instrument the binary and then we implement the right bits and pieces that we need with this instrumentation, then we could implement something that has or that implements the execution handling that we are waiting for. And also fiber implementations for PHP 8 could be of help. And then for mod Wasm, what we want to do is to be able to load multiple WebAssembly modules, so you can define as many as you want in your config, Also, you might want to have different Wasm-enabled capabilities per module. So one module might be able to access a certain directory, other maybe not. Also, multi-engine support. So right now, we only support Wasm time, but in the future, we might support others because in the end, these engines might be more performant for certain operations, and we might want to use those engines, or the user might want to use those engines for these specific things. We can run on Kubernetes environments with support for WASI, as AKS, for example. This is something we can also do. We could pull modules. So instead of having to prefill or to give or copy the modules beforehand into the file system, we could pull this from a server. It could be a registry, it could be an HTTP server, something that we can pull these modules from. And also additional language framework support. In theory, if it implements CGI, we will be able to run it, but we haven't tested it. We have to try and see how it goes. This is part of the future that we want to check. Also in terms of logging and debugging, things that we need to also invest time on it. Okay, so as the summary of this talk is, first of all, we have Module Wasm, which enables Apache to execute WebAssembly modules. This already opens a big world because lots of things can be compiled into WebAssembly, right? So now we have Apache that enables all this world. Then the second part is we have PHP, which is ported to Wasm 32 WASI. And then we have WordPress and other web apps that can run unmodified on the server side. And then all the benefits of Wasm now are available to all the developers. So, and the most important things about this today, I think, is security. Because with this, we have a more secure environment, and we had a lot of deployments that we have seen, WordPress 30, 40%. Many of these things will be secure by default, or more secure by default, without any change, right? So this is what we are expecting, and this is what we want to tell the world, right? So we want to gain all these developers. So give it a try. We have wasmlabs.dev. We have written articles on how we have done this. So provide feedback. We are really open to whatever you want to tell us. And follow us on Twitter. And with that, thank you. If you have any questions,